We give you a formal warning, that is a warning official from your court, which means that if they disobey it, it will be a real problem and trouble for them, because it was officially given. Formal warning. We give you a formal warning not to preach in this name. And what have you done? You have filled the whole Jerusalem with your teaching. You would expect people to say, "Come, sir." Don't be alarmed, sir. As women, you and I today, as the apostles, and our conference of bishops and high priests, I don't know what other names we have for them, that I can use to explain better, but I'm using what we know to describe less well. As women, you are the apostles, and women, this name of Jesus is new. As women, it is a new name. As women, Christianity is just beginning. As women, Jesus has just risen from the dead this very night on Easter morning. And all our priests and bishops will sleep and say to you, "Who is this man you are talking about? Ba 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 ba, we don't know him, we don't believe in him." As women, we're just as women. I know the first thing you will do. The first thing is, the bishops have said they don't know the man. Even Father in my parish has said they don't know him. You will go and tell somebody else. The bishops have said we shouldn't talk about him again. The bishops have said we should not mention him again. And my parish priest too has agreed that they don't agree with that man. That the man is safe, that he did. So, you will shut up your mouth at once. And just go back to us and say, "Well, the servants will be, the bishops are the head of the church, and the priests are the head of the church, they represent Christ. Anything they say, we don't do it." Come to the real heaven. So I want us to go back and put ourselves in the real context of Peter and the apostles. That's why I'm using our own present day terminology for church hierarchy to explain it to you. Just as an example. I know if it were you and I today, the first thing is, I want us to say, once they had the hierarchy of the church has said, we don't have to finish, not there. Because that's the mentality of the layman. Just whatever they said to do, do it. Whatever the hierarchy says, just do it. They said, don't do it. Don't do it. Myself too, I will do the same. I'm not just talking about you. I can assure you that even me. Once the bishops say one thing, finish that day, as far as I'm concerned. If they say it is wrong, oh, thank you. I believe you know better. But God has entrusted the church to you to tell us what to do and show us the way. I will just drop the thing and say, "Open to God." That was the situation with Peter and the apostles. How do you say? These men were the hierarchy, they were the authority, they were the leader of their religion at the time. They were the leaders of their religion, of the Jewish religion. The religion into which they were born, all the apostles were born. They were the religion, they were the leaders of the religion, even the religion in which he was himself. Found himself as man. When he came as God made man. There are the authorities in charge of the temple, the synagogue, the everything, everything to do with worship. And authorizing or not authorizing things that have to do with worship and everything. What was hundreds of young vessels by that time. That's why I'm telling you this. We have to get this right. This was not their joke until that point. For this to be settled by this man, this way, excuse me, that's not funny. That wasn't their joke. And then to be commanded, warned, formally, officially.
I am sure
action. That's the word ban. When they say give you a formal warning, not to preach in the name of this man again, or to preach this man's name. In other words, they have been what? They have been banned. There was a ban on preaching or talking, in fact, mentioning the name of Jesus at all. Nobody was to follow him, nobody was to preach in his name, and don't mention his name. They wanted Jesus to be dead after his crucifixion. We have killed him, and in killing him, they wanted his name also to be killed, and his name never to be remembered. Talk about being mentioned. He was not able to be remembered. They wanted him dead. They buried him in the tomb, put a sword, finished with that man called Jesus. With his body and his name and with everything to die, bow. And these men are there, talking about him, shouting at his name, talking, telling the whole. And then they ban them from being so. And the next day, what they hear, that the people in the land, they are out there, they are shouting loud. If they had megaphone or microphone, they would, I'm sure they would have carried on. Whatever it is that will make the crowd to hear their voices properly. They must have had it to them to project their voices to the crowds that gathered around them. And they did not stop walking, they just kept going, until the news was all over Jerusalem. The story of the man Jesus, even people who did not know before, now got to know, now that he died. Because the apostle is coming to proclaim against all odds, at great risk to themselves, their family, their reputation, at the cost of their lives, they were ready to suffer whatever. Nothing was going to stop them from obeying their master, Jesus, who said, go ye, proclaim the good news. I like that woman. They are like people who only hear good. They don't stop until they hear call from the same master. How I wish all of us would be like that. Not so that you are good, you start to jump and go. Before you go halfway, you come back. Nobody calling you back. So that's what they did. They went and they continued to proclaim. And then, the Sanhedrin got there, summoned them, arrested them, brought before their council. Yes. Come on, you these people, you must think you're guilty. We gave you 4 miles. They have to explain to them 4 miles of fiscal law. Not as a joke. Not a personal young man or woman. We give it to you as a group. Who are the authorities of your religion? The God in the beginning. And who? We said, don't take this man's name anymore. What have you done? What have you done? You've done the whole thing. You've gone and killed the first person with your teaching. What was the teaching? He was there. Of course, you can be sure that by the time they're talking to him, that it's just the man, the God, they were expecting that they would be called again. They were expecting to be rearrested. And I'm sure they know that the penalty will be serious if they are to be called back. They will walk from the court. So they were prepared to stand the consequence, to face whatever it was, whatever the sector, whatever the reason, they were ready for it. Before they became that stubborn to continue to preach against all odds, knowing that they would be banned from doing so, they knew the repercussion would come, but they were prepared for the repercussion. Their minds are ready for it. So when they stubborn them, no problem at all. By the time they finish talking, expecting them, thinking that they were talking to the king, fishermen, king, uneducated class, illiterate, most of them, people who have no knowledge of stop your getting shot. When he brought me to box in front of him and the plan, very boldly, without any apologies, with no humility in his voice, never taking the answer. Obedience to God comes before obedience to men. By that statement alone, Peter was saying something. Who knows what Peter was doing? Let's see who we get it. By that statement alone, Peter was saying something. Yes? Clap for her. Can you get my letter today? Next time we don't go without getting my letter. By telling him, we gave you a formal warning to ban you from talking about this man, and you don't beat him everywhere. Here's the word of it. Peter looked at them, broken, unintimidated, and said, obedience to God is better than obedience to man. Obedience to God comes before obedience to men. Peter will simply say one simple thing in English. That is who I am obeying to God. And that you are nothing but mere man. Philip, you are thinking. What should you have heard from us? We have asked for lesser orders than him. What is it? You still want back. Mere men. Fast, keep your advice. And the perfect people are here. God. The perfect people. In the presence of God. Because it was Jesus that gave them the mandate to go and proclaim. Go and proclaim the good news to others. It was Jesus that gave the mandate. So when Peter said, obedience to God, comes before obedience to men, he has concluded the matter. Jesus is God. You are nothing but a human being like me. And I don't have to listen to you. So he put them in their position. Put them where they belong, near water. You and I, the same level. Whatever your title, high priest, the Sanhedrin, whatever, you are just a human being. But this Jesus, who sent me to preach, he is God. By having Peter unequivocally proclaimed Jesus God, unshakingly, unintimidatedly said, Jesus is God. That thing they don't want to hear. Remember, that's what they don't want to hear. Remember, who cried it? Are you the Son of God? Are you this and that? All that Jesus said is, you have said to. Hey, abomination. Hey, they thought they are closed. Hey, thought they are closed. Hey, 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 hey. He answered it. Now, what are you looking for? Blasphemy. Kill him. They didn't even want to hear that he is the Son of God. Now, Peter is saying, he is God. Your for Peter. That Peter did not want to hear on Good Friday. That Peter did not want to hear on Good Friday. They are telling him openly, boldly, from the mouth of a former king is a man. He is God. And he alone will I serve. He alone will I obey. He has sent me, and obedience to him comes before obedience to you. Because he is God. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And so from that Jerusalem. To now try to explain to them. It was God of our ancestors who raised up Jesus, but it was you who had him executed, etc., etc. For me, that one is just trying to make them see reason, which of course they're not able to see. But the point of today's talk is this. What I call holy stubbornness. What is it?
Holy stubbornness.
People of God, stubbornness is said to be a vice. Mr. Singh. Hold on around the person. But this, I want us to look at this word, stubbornness and hostility, and see when you can become a virtue. This is an example of how stubbornness becomes a virtue. This is an example of what I call holy hostility, holy stubbornness. There are times when we have to be stubborn. There are times when we don't have to shake over every so-called authority. There are times when we don't have to panic over everything that people are telling us do or don't do. There are times when you don't have to have a mind of your own. There are times when you are bound by the law of God to do certain things against all odds and against whatever human beings are saying. This is one of such occasions. Failing to do so, you suffer for it under a higher authority, under a greater power that is greater than those for whom you shakingly bow. There are times you have to understand and identify whose voice we obey. To whom am I accountable this time around? There are times you don't have to discern whose power is greater than whose power. And which of them am I now to bow to? Can women have power? High priest have authority. Of course, given to them by God. And that was what Jesus tried to explain to them to misunderstand his grammar. When he told them, you will have no power over me if it has not been given to you from above. Then he told them, I acknowledge your power, not that I don't want to assign it. But know that that power comes from God. And you're not exercising power anymore, let's finish it again. And the first one, the thing I wanted to tell you too, even the basic one, that is simple as it is. So why the Sanhedrin and the high priest have power, have authority given to them by God? Yes. And Jesus acknowledges that their power comes from God. Be silent, whoever is governing, your power comes from God. But the apostles are saying something today. While acknowledging that the power of the Sanhedrin and the authority and their position came from God, they have to now decide whom do we obey in this matter of preaching the good news. The people that God gave power to, or the God that gave the power. We're talking about what I would call holy stubbornness. While stubbornness is said to be a vice, while obstinacy is a vice we do not want to call to this, I am trying to look at this scenario of Peter, the apostle, and the Sanhedrin in the early Christian faith. When they were banned from preaching or talking about the name Jesus, and given a formal warning by the authorities of their religion that you can compare today with what we can call the Bishop's Conference or even higher. It's like getting a letter from Rome telling you, stop that thing you are doing, to turn around. The next day, you are all over the place proclaiming what you are proclaiming. You stand the chance of being excommunicated, if nothing else. And the authority of the Jewish religion in those days, they didn't have authority. They could determine what happens to you. Which was why, even Jesus, was taken to the high priest and they had a say in his crucifixion. And what was to become of him? To show you how strong and powerful they were. acción, el curso de la vida humana, el karma, la vida de la vida humana, and what it could do to them. But Peter looked at them and said to them, obedience to God comes before obedience to man. Thereby proclaiming that Jesus is God and we are mere human beings. Therefore, I know him to obey because my Lord Jesus said to me before he left that all of us go through the whole good news and we have to obey him. In giving that answer, Peter was obviously and openly, unintimidatedly proclaiming that Jesus Christ, whom you had crucified, is God. And you, even though he gave you power, you are not a human being. And I would like to add, without being asked to add, human beings who abuse your position, sorry. So I'm adding that question. In addition to what you said, you are mere human beings. And these human beings who abuse their position, who abuse their authority, and who are blind and could not see, to show the rest of God the right way. That was what the point is. People recognizing them what they have come themselves to, were no longer ready to obey. Because by crucifying the Son of God, an innocent man, they didn't deserve any more in life of people and their bosses.
The behavior was there, showing absence of the Holy Spirit.
Westfield, they would have recognized Jesus for who he really was, and would not have had him put to death. That was why Peter decided to disobey them. That was why the apostles knew who to obey. Because they had become filled with the Holy Spirit and could now analyze and put things together and all that happened to their master. And it was obvious that those who had been crucified certainly did not listen to the Holy Spirit. They may be calling themselves men of God, but you cannot be a man of God without the Holy Spirit in you. And when you call yourself a man of God, chief priest, high priest, whatever you want to call yourself, church council, without the Holy Spirit acting in you, working in you, directing you, leading you, you will be acting blindly. And nobody wants to follow a blind leader, because we all have a mistake. So the apostles were quite ready to suffer anything, to disengage themselves from this group of human beings who were obviously blind in the sense of killing the Son of God. And to follow him, who is the way, the truth, the life, they had seen him for what he really was, the Son of God. They witnessed it on Mount Tabor. They saw it in his life. They saw it at his crucifixion. And they have seen it again at his resurrection and post-resurrection. And they saw it again upon his ascension into heaven. What else do they need? To let them know that this band of people that call themselves and living and giving and hiding have no knowledge. They have no understanding. And that something was lacking there. Something wasn't lacking. Was the Holy Spirit. Who they refused to listen to, intent upon their own mind and headset. Intent upon their own mindset that they will not refuse, that they will not agree to let go of. Believing whatever they wanted to believe, condemning the truth. When it comes to that kind of a situation, my dear brothers and sisters, that is the place to bring in what I'm talking about. Holy disobedience. That's holy disobedience. If you like, you want disobedience to send to the ungodly. But I'm not telling you that there are occasions that you have to be disobedient. There are occasions where you have to say no. Even if it is the so-called authority that are talking to you or telling you to do something. You have to first of all check. Who is speaking? What spirit is speaking in them? The person giving you command and telling you what to do, or prohibiting you from listening to the Lord or doing what God wants, what spirit is talking in this person? What power is at work in this person? Yes, power is given from God. Yes, but people can abuse their power. Authority comes from God. But authority can be abused. When authority is being abused and now becoming misleading, should you continue to follow that authority? Should you continue to obey that authority? Should you continue to act according to their dictates? Big question mark. That is what for me today's reading is talking about and bringing out. Because there comes a day when you and I must become Peter. There comes a day in our life when you and I must become the apostles before the Sanhedrin. There comes a day, sooner or later, which it has not already happened in your life, when you have to become Peter and the apostles standing in front of high priest, chief priest, synagogue priest, whatever they are, authorities that are supposed to be the guiding authority, that are supposed to be the leading powers, that are supposed to be the lawmakers, that are supposed to be the everything. And here you have to be a Peter, who you have to say to them, excuse me, I have said what you said, but I'm sorry, I cannot do what you're telling me to do. I have heard you, but I'm sorry, I have to obey God.
But really, obedience to God comes before obedience to man. There comes a day in your life, if it has not already happened, where you don't have to take a stand. A stand on what you believe, a stand with your conscience, a stand for God, a stand for the truth. Take a stand, even at the risk of your life, at the risk of your communication, at the risk of whatever it may be. There comes a time in the life of each one when you have to stand. That was the stand Peter and the apostles were taking. They refused his name, whether to stand with and the churches of the high priest wanted or not. If Jesus, the Son of God, who sent them, is able to deliver them from their hands, from being killed, martyred, beaten, fine. And even if he doesn't, we will still obey him and preach him. It is your call. I see what I'm talking about, and this message Peter is sending in today's news. I think that's a call. It's a call to your mind today. What is your faith? Are you standing for it? What is your proof? That you can say, this is your standing proof that I know. It's irreversible. Irreversible truth. Irreversible the truth. And I prepare to die for it. Because I know it is the truth. Do you have any such factor in your life? For which you can say, I'm going to live my life. Is there anything in your life that you can say, I'm ready to die for it? Because I know I can vouch, and I know it what it is. Or you are just a wind blown by every wind. You are just a leaf blown by every wind to the left to the right, wherever the blow will go. Shaky, shaky. They have said, don't do it again, no. They have said, don't talk again, no. No, I won't talk again, I don't want to talk. They have said, don't go, I won't go. They have said, that place is not good. I don't want to. They have said. Where is that coming from? That makes you think of your neck. Think of your neck for what is living. Where is that coming from? That makes you be sharp when they are saying, shut up. You only shout louder. You are reserved for this government. That will make you run faster. When everybody says, slow down now, take it easy, okay. Be careful now, so that you don't enter trouble. Be careful. If you don't enter trouble though, everybody will condemn you. You will be excommunicated, you will do don't take it easy. You are reserved for this government that makes you to say no. Even if the whole world is excommunicated. Even if my village is communicating, even if the dear man is communicating, even if the old man asks in my village is communicating, I am not going to stop and I'm not slowing down in what I believe. What I know is what I know and I stand for it. We are in that holy covenant. Yes. He said, when you now begin to do that thing that is told, don't go, slow down, take it easy, so that you don't get into trouble. This is just a stroll and don't want trouble. Either you start doing something, human doing something, or you begin to be sneaky. Sneaky. You now find yourself to be Pokemon. You become the Pokemon. Who is going to deny? To go and meet Jesus, when nobody can see. He believes so, he knows so. And meeting Jesus, he knew he was the Son of God. But he will go and make sure that the people don't identify him with Jesus. After they identify what he believes. There are some like that. They don't want to be identified before they believe. Out of fear. Out of fear. Like I said, there comes a time in the life of each of us that we must stand up for what we believe in and choose to decide it. Or whatever the power to play with. There comes a time in our life that we must sit up, even at the cost of our life. We must sit up at the cost of being communicated. We must sit up at the cost of being wanted or whatever. person wants to do. There are certain times in the life of each one that we must stand up for God and for the things of God. All this useless vanity, vanity, fear, fear, that is why Christianity is no longer moving to the extent it ought to have moved by now. There are too many fear, fear Christians all over the place. Too many fear, fear believers. Too many mediocre Christians. Too many who are afraid of the king. Too many who are afraid of what people will say. Too many who are afraid of what the authority will do. Who are the authority? Remember what he said. You will have no authority over me. Instead, it is given to you from there above. So what do you hear? You want one great authority to you, or you basically have great authority to him. Who is this answer? Peter has given all the answers. Obedience to God comes before obedience to man. Simple as that is. And that is a new affection that all of us must incorporate, invite, and begin to give back. Worship the God from whom power comes. Worship the God who is the giver of authority. Worship Him who is the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning, and the end. To the Lord shall we pray. For who alone is God, in heaven above and on earth beneath, king and none other, bow before Him. There are no two gods. There are every power, every authority. But only one is important. The Lord, who has the power over your life? Who can determine your will? Who determines your future? And remember what God said. Anyone who tries to save his life will lose it. You try to save your life, will lose it. But you save your life, then you lose it. So we have to know this thing. And now we have to stop and we have to draw the line. You want to be a reverend father? And your mother or your father says, you cannot. You say, Daddy, I have prayed, and God is calling me to serve Him. And your father or your mother says, my son, I say no, you cannot go. You are the only child I have. Or, if you are not the only one, you are the most intelligent, you are the one I'm relying on to take care of me, look after me my whole day. And you turn down. You don't want to be with your parents. You have done what? You have obeyed man and disobeyed God because your vocation, your call comes from God. And then you tell some people, they say, the Bible says, honor your father and your mother. Since your father says, you cannot be a king, therefore you cannot be a king. Please, come again. I'm opening my ears to hear you well. Say it again. Say it again. Say it again to the life of me. And I'm standing here for you. But I'm one of those that disobeyed my parents to become a sister. I am one of those that standing here. I disobeyed. If you use the word to call it disobedience. If you call that disobedience, then here I am. I do not call it disobedience. I call it Peter, because I did not study. Obedience to God comes before obedience to man. Simple, that's what I have to tell my parents. God is calling me and I go. Simple as A, B, C. It is true in your person. It is true. First commandment, honor thy father and thy mother. But then we have to now decide. When it comes to God is talking, my mother is talking, which of the two voices do I obey? But you must still tell your children, obey your parents, because God gave them power over you. Is that not something to say? That's not to say. And you have made many astray by that statement. Obey your parents. God bless your soul, man. Even when you know that God is calling them to come and answer his call to do something, obey. You cannot think that you will obey when you what was I to do? I don't think I want grammar to do that. Because there is no comparison. The question should not arise. If your parents are really obeying God, they will help you to obey Him. If your parents themselves obey God at the moment, they are the ones who teach you and hand you over to God. When you say, Daddy, the Lord is calling you to come to His service. Your parents will immediately join you in prayer and reception. And the day you are going, you'll be the one to lead you to the altar of God. They must not stand between you and God. And then be telling you to obey us because you have power over you. By the time they start doing that, they are setting themselves up as rivals with God. They are putting themselves side by side with God and now making you to say, you have to choose between us and God. And if it's not to choose between you and God, of course, God is my choice. Because it is a sign that you, my parents, biological, you are no longer God fearing. If I'm not doing something evil, and I'm going to do something good, to answer God's call, which is the fact, the best anybody can do, how can you be telling them not to go? That is a sign of absence of the Holy Spirit in them. They have not the Spirit of God in them. Just like this Thanksgiving and Christmas have left the Spirit of God in them. There is an absence of the Holy Spirit, which was also making them to tell Peter, never preach in that name again. Apostles, you don't want to hear that name again. Nobody that has the Holy Spirit can tell you not to follow God. Nobody that has the Holy Spirit can tell you not to worship God. Nobody who has the Holy Spirit can bring an obstacle between you and God. What I call fully covenant and fully covenant is going to come across human beings who show signs of wrath, absence of the Holy Spirit. In the way they talk, in the way they behave, you can see signs. You may not be able to judge for people because God is the ultimate judge. But when I begin to see signs, this one, this thing you are telling me to do, I don't think this is God. This is not anything. I don't have to believe. Because for them, and if you obey the devil that has possessed you, and if you obey the devil that has entered you and is speaking to you, and that is the time to say, no. The God is better. The Lord, my God alone, shall I serve. He alone will I worship. And to him I fly. You fly to God for refuge, for protection. I trust God to save you from their clutches, the clutches of the so-called powers or authorities, or parents, or whoever they will be. And even if he does not save you from their hands, die in the hand of God. Better to die in the hand of God than to die in the hand of enemies of God who have lost everything God. Are you doubting the fact that even your parents can now be operating for the devil and not for God? Are you doubting the fact that it can happen? It can happen. Are you doubting the fact that leaders and who or whatever group, big village, whatever, are you doubting that sometimes the devil can operate with them? Are you doubting that? Are you doubting the fact that sometimes they are not talking from the Holy Spirit point of view? Is there any doubt about that? Sometimes they do, sometimes they may not. Okay, but what you need to do is go through your discernment process. And to know when somebody is trying to prevent you from following God. And you must never listen to anybody who forbids you from following God. You must never listen to anybody who forbids you from following God. Tell that person you are not from God, it's God from you. You don't have to do. And I don't care who that person is in your life. Some will say, obey. listened to God's judgment. I have heard that before. A certain woman was having conflict with the husband over what God was calling her to do. And the argument became, which direction to go? The husband was, you cannot do it, at the head of this house. At the head of the family, you cannot. And the person, the woman was saying, I pray, I beg, and this is what the Lord is telling me to do. And the man is, I am the head of the house. And your Bible, the Bible says, woman, what is the thing that you put in? What does that mean?
Be submissive to your husband. Be submissive to your
woman, be submissive to your husband, for he is the head of the house, whatever. And what else? Whatever that is. The first thing I said is, have you reported to your parents what your problem is? Yes. What your parents is this? I don't want to go. So that I will tell me that. The person told me what parents is this. I can't find it. Because in my mind, you are coming to me now, like I will say, and you go and say, Mr. Federer, then. I have to be determined to know how to handle the matter. So what I did was pass the woman through a session of counseling and guidance. So by herself, she arrived at what to do. Without me saying two other things. Then they say she told her to disobey the husband and even the marriage. So I just start asking a session of questions, things of questions. Here, there, they are good. They said, okay, do novena, do fasting, do marriage, and listen again. For a while. I don't know the thing. Nobody told her what the answer should be. And of course, she acted right. It was time to stand for God. It was time to stand for God. Whatever about this in the home, you know, just do whatever the people are doing. Peace. When you are looking for peace, the house is scattering more. Because how can you put God aside and start worshiping your man and his will? And you can see that obviously what he's telling you to do, what he's trying to stop you from doing, for what purpose was for selfish reason and worship. And you want to listen and obey so I can repeat. That is when there will never be true peace in that house. You cannot crucify the King of Peace and expect peace to be in the house. You cannot reject peace, who is God, and expect that there is peace between you and your husband. And all under the name of the Bible says, the man is the head. This is the time to quote, as Jesus quoted for them on Good Friday. You will have no authority over me if it had not been given to you from above. A reminder, just remind the man or whoever, this authority you are putting on head, you will not be head over me if God gives you this. Therefore, bow your head to God and let both of us worship God together. Join me, Captain Eva, for the Lord can make you head. Let's bow. Listen to that head. But you come on my neck. And they will tell you, Just the thing, somebody said to her, she said it's his friend, told her, just the thing, and give him to John God's judgment. Uh-huh. And I'm like, what kind of, look at that. Look at what? Let the Holy Spirit tell me. And she said it to somebody with this nonsensical ideology that is obviously contrary to God, and obey him, and then said, because he's the head, I will just obey. If I obey, God will understand that I'm obeying because the scripture says so. Judge me. And he said, what to carry the sin? They're not going to move. They're not going to carry the sin. They're not going to say, what about me? In fact, you should ask my opinion. I don't think your husband will carry anything. Why do you say so? Because he did not hear the voice of heaven.
All of them.
Did I say so? Did I say so? Did I say so? Obedience to God. And that is when you yourself are sure it is God you are obeying. All around, just go here and obey your parents. Be submissive to your parents. Only in cases like this, Peter's case and the submission, is what I'm talking about. There is God's confidence. Take note. Not in any other situation. Only in cases like this, passage we are reading today. And your wife too. Don't go and say somebody has said it's obey your husband. That's not true. Only in cases like what? The work in the passage of people. You are thinking your husband is forbidding you from proclaiming, from serving God, from doing the things of God. That is where you show him that obedience to God comes out of the obedience to man. That's what I'm talking about. Children to their parents, the same thing. To read the vision, to whatever authority it will be, the same thing applies. Obey to state authority. Except when they start guarding you, or trying to prevent you, serving God, from worshiping God, from listening to the voice of God, and the rest of that is the time you have to say what you can say. Obedience to God comes before obedience to man. Not in any other situation. I have not authorized you to do that. You're not authorized to do that in any other situation, except in such situations, and that is if Peter and the apostles found themselves. There's one thing that I can boast about. You see, a lot of reverend fathers and reverend sisters, we are very stubborn. That is where you see stubborn sisters and stubborn people. Go and ask a lot of reverend fathers how they became things. They will tell you the battle they have to face, either with their biological parents, or their immediate family, or their siblings. And they just have to speak out their head, speak out their own position. And what we say now, it gives everybody's advice. It gives family support. It gives parental support. And they are happy reverend fathers today to the glory of God. Clap for them. That's telling government. On the day of ordination, the mother will now come and come and showcase mama and father. Yeah, father. If the father should open mouth on the day of ordination and tell the congregation what his eyes saw and the pepper he went through, the day he announced, "I want to go through," he will feel sorry. And you will not want to bring mama and father again. A real sister, I love family of God. Let family against all odds. And this fire, when I say this fire, in the midst of fire, we went through it in order to answer the call of God. To go and proclaim the good news. To become his own, to be used by God, a vessel for God. I know what we went through. Still in Africa, maybe over here, the world governor, in Africa, there is hardly an African sister or priest that is not suffer for the sake of Christ. And not as if they are going to become a sister to become rich. They are not going for money. They are not going for the wealth of the world. They are going to find out poverty, celibacy, all that. Still, to suffer. And we have to say no to the voices that are trying to silence our vocation. We have to say no. Obedience to God comes before obedience to man. We have to say no to siblings, to family. No in the things of the world. No in several directions. We have to keep shouting. God says, obedience to God comes before it all. Before any other thing. Today, we are happy that we did. Anyway, I don't know about that. I am happy. Very, very happy. And like I say, if there's anything like coming back to this world, if I come back again, I will still answer this same call. and not others. I will still answer God's call. I will still consecrate. I will still consecrate to God. I will still give my life to God. The Lord and the cross. That is what I call holy stubbornness. Many of us have to really stubborn.
Whatever.
I don't know because I was waiting for anything. I waited. 1 minute, 2 minutes, 5 minutes. No, don't you know? You are the truth. Of course, I have kept my waiting and I had to quit paying mass for everything before coming to 2007. But I never wanted to hear. I sit down and waited to be whatever they did to me. 2 miles of pride. 2 miles of pride. The one I thought would descend with hammer was the one that came with a beautiful answer. The one I thought would say, let me rally around my daughter, was the one that came out with fire.
You lose your respect, you lose your integrity. I have to be saying that some of your parents
Anything
and everybody. When it comes to God, doing what God has called you to do, sent you to do, no shaking, no looking back. Be ready to suffer whatever for the sake of Christ. Be ready never to allow yourself to be intimidated by anybody. That's what I'm talking about today. The more they try to subdue you, the louder you shout.
I need to.
Refusing to bend when it comes to doing the matters of God.